Good morning, everybody. You're welcome again to Encounters with the Holy Spirit. You're going to receive such an encounter with the Holy Spirit that it will move you to your real level. Before we start today, can we bow our heads to pray this short prayer? Everlasting Father, we say thank you for your word we're about to hear. Lord Jesus, teach us in the way only you know how to teach us, in the way we would understand, in the way we'll hear you, God. Let us hear you, God. Father, Lord, take over this atmosphere. Do what you do when you come into a place. Lord, take over. Take over. Let all glory, all adoration return to you. For in Jesus' most powerful name, amen. Again, good morning. You're welcome. Today we'll be continuing You Are Valuable. I'll just continue from where I stopped. You're valuable. Alright, so our text that we used for the first part was John 3:16. I love popular Bible verses because most times people overlook things that they feel are popular, and that's where the main things are. Alright, John 3:16, it says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son." So you cannot say you love a person, you cannot say someone is precious to you without showing it by giving something important. Yeah, I'm going there. "That whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." So I'm just going to summarize what I did in the first one, then we'll flow into today's part. I said, number one, in the first part, nobody attacks what isn't valuable. Nobody attacks what isn't valuable. If you don't see value in something, you won't bother attacking it. You just let it go. And I remember giving an illustration with like a mango tree or a fruit tree. People will pass by that tree normally, won't even blink. But when is a mango, when is it mango season, everybody will be looking there to look for a ripe mango to throw it down, to bring it down, to eat it. So nobody attacks what isn't valuable. Nobody attacks it. They just let it go because they're like, why will I waste my energy? Why will I waste my time, my effort on that thing? It's not valuable, so I just leave it alone. So note that nobody attacks what isn't valuable. The next thing I said is, and I wrote it as per personal, if Jesus went to the cross for me, then I must be very valuable. I'm not just valuable, I must be very valuable for God to go to the cross for me, for Jesus to come and endure the pain and the shame. See, and people of God, if you imagine how the pain Jesus went through, not the one that he left heaven and came to earth and became a normal man. That was one. Then they now said, if you read the thing, they said they stripped him, they flogged him, they knew all the whole pains he went through just for me. Then please, whatever is telling me I'm not valuable, that is a dirty liar, because for God to go through that whole thing just for me, I am very, very valuable. I want that to stick in your head. Say, I am very, very valuable. The next thing I said is this: the size of your storm tells how important your destiny is to God and to the devil. The size of your storm tells how important your destiny is to God and to the devil. Like I said, the first one, nobody attacks what isn't valuable. So now your storm is looking too big, because the devil knows that your destiny is so important. It's so important. So if he lets you stay like that, he will disturb him. And I gave the illustration with Judah. Judah, his name means praise, yeah. And it was, I think, Judah, a son of Jacob, Israel. Now, he had sons. His brothers too had sons. But his own was very peculiar, that his first son got married, and instead of him to be expecting a grandson or a granddaughter, the son died. The second son got married to the woman, the first son's wife, as per tradition. He's not expecting a grandchild again. That one died. So he's only like, why are my sons dying? And he did not even understand that, because God has already marked him, because God knows the end of a matter from the beginning. God has already written that in this lineage of Judah, a David will appear from this lineage. A Jesus Christ will appear from this lineage. Great people are going to come out of this lineage. So the devil, this Judah lineage is very important too, so we have to cut it off, because it is from the sons now that the whole lineage will come out from, because the daughters will go and get married to somebody and they'll begin to flourish on that person's lineage. So the devil start attacking all the sons there, and in the eyes of Judah has finished having his whole children. So in the devil did not know that God is, that's why I like that song, the extraordinary strategist. He had no idea that God still had a master plan still with him. Wasted the son so that no male heir will come out of that place. and God nasty allowed it. Looked like a mistake that this guy was making a mistake, but God out of that mistake brought out something beautiful, brought out the lineage of David, which automatically became the lineage of Jesus Christ. So from that mess, from that mistake, God can bring out something beautiful, and I see him bringing out something beautiful and excellent for you. I don't know who this is for, but God is bringing out something beautiful from that area that you think you have messed up big time. God is saying, I will bring out something so beautiful that it will be telling the world that I am still God in your life. He's bringing out something beautiful in your life. All right, so in that lineage, that's how the guy made the mistake, in quote. Yes, he made the mistake. And from there, David came, the guy that God said, a man after my own heart. The David, the king, the man after my own heart, that God was referring to him very, very well, hailing him anyhow you like. Then, in that same lineage again, Solomon went to go and mess up. God did not bother. God said, here is this same lineage. I will still corner everything, and my son will come out of here. So the devil knew how important that lineage was, and he was trying to mess it up. But God says, I am still the Alpha and the Omega. I have begun it, I will complete it. So any area in your life that God has begun something, know this for certain, that he that started a good thing in your life must bring it to accomplishment. The devil cannot cut God's work short. I'm summarizing it. Then the next thing I said was this: the devil does not start a storm for a person who he isn't threatened by. If the devil doesn't feel threatened by you, he won't bother with you. Like I said about the mango tree, if I don't feel threatened by you, why would I bother? I was watching a movie one day, and one lady was catwalking and whatever around one woman's husband. They were trying to seduce the woman's husband. The woman just smiled. She was like, she's not my husband's spec, so he won't even bother with her. He will bother with this kind of other people. So she was not moved. She was not even threatened to them, because she knew this one cannot even disturb her husband at all. It's the one that she knew the type of people that her husband likes. So that's how the devil is. He knows this person is serious threat to me, so I fight this one. This one, so I know important. You send the small demons to those ones. But the ones I know, these people, he will come by himself, come and fight them, because he knows they are very important. So most times, your storm, that does not excuse the fact that if you sin and lower the air, the serpent will bite you. It is not only when the serpent, but just say yes, because my destiny is great. Sometimes you brought the problem on yourself. So don't always be shouting my destiny is great when you put yourself inside trouble, because God can decide to help you, but sometimes it can be your own handwork. All right, so the next thing I said is that the storm means God is on the way. When the devil fights the hardest, most times your miracle is just very close. The biggest battles are at the edge of your miracle. The night is darkest before the morning comes. So when you see the storm coming, where you know you are doing everything right before God, you are doing everything, you've done prayer of inquiry, you've done everything, and yet there's still problem, know that your miracle is so close. God's already on his way. It's about making the best thing for you. So relax and know that the one that has sent me is able and just to take me to the finish line. The next thing I said was, the enemy will always attack whatever is most valuable to you. You attack whatever is most valuable to you. And I said also that the most valuable thing to a person is his relationship with God. The devil attacks whatever is most valuable to you, and the most valuable thing to you is your relationship with God. Look at Adam and Eve. Adam and Eve were in the garden. The devil was just hoving on them. When he did not bother to go and say, I will take your apple tree, I will take your mango tree. No, he went for the thing that will cut off their relationship with God, and once he did that, he left them alone. He's not bothered them again. He just left them alone. So the devil always attacks the most valuable thing, and you'll be thinking that it's your money. It's not your money, it's your relationship with God. Joshua told him, curse God and die, meaning cut your relationship with God and die. The moment your relationship with God is gone, you are empty, you are nothing. Which brings me to today's point. Now, the next thing I want us to write for today, now, you are empty without God. Once your relationship with God is cut off, you are empty. Adam and Eve lost everything. It was just it's not just one this thing, just one small disobedience, they lost everything. Job's wife cursed God and died. Once he cursed God, he's dead. He becomes worthless to the enemy. The only reason why the devil was hammering him was because he still had a relationship with God. The devil knew he still has a source of strength, he still has a hope. But if I remove his hope from me, if I remove his relationship with God, he's now worthless, he's worth nothing to me. That's the thing. So your relationship with God, very important to you. If you lose your relationship with God, you are empty. Without God in your life, you are empty. So if you are watching this right now and God is not your master, your Lord and Savior, brother, sister, know you are very, very empty. Just know it in your mind that you are empty. The next thing I want us to know that for today is this: your relationship with God empowers you. Your relationship with God empowers you. Have you not seen most times, my father used this as an illustration, if the president is passing now in his convoy, everybody be clear, pia, 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 pia. And the president can only be inside one car, and there are like 20 cars there, but everybody is respecting the convoy because
there's a relationship with the president. But the moment you leave that convoy now and you don't drive by your own, the way the bus is in this Lagos will push you left, right, center. It will shock you. So your relationship with God empowers you. Your relationship that you have with God empowers you. The people that are following the convoy of the president or the governor or whatever, they are empowered. They can tell people, get out of the road, shift away from the road, because they know they are carrying, they are following the person that has power, that has authority. The moment that thing is cut off, finish you. So your relationship with God is very important. Guard it jealously. The next thing we can write down for today is this: nobody invest in what they don't see value in. Nobody invest in what they don't see value in. If I don't see value in something, I'm not investing my money there. That's the same thing. Like, many people are investing in cryptocurrency because they can see value in it. If I don't see value in something, I won't invest in it. So for God to come and say, I want to die for you, I want to come and cut, allow the devil to chuk me with spear, with nail, flog me, everything, it means he saw something in you. So if God, that is God, creator of everything, can see value in you, can see value in me, why will you be telling yourself that you're not valuable? You are so valuable. In fact, you are very valuable. The Bible says, the cost of one soul is more worth more than the whole earth. So that's how important you are to God. Very valuable. That God is ready to crush the whole earth just for one you. Why are you not telling yourself you are not valuable? You are super valuable, super valuable. So nobody invests in what you don't see value in. You invest in something, you invest in somebody, you invest in an idea. People come and pitch ideas to you and tell you, oh, this business is moving, and you now go and do your research. If you don't see value in it, you won't invest. That person, no, I'm busy now, I've invested in other places, so maybe next time, because you don't see value in it. But if you see value in it, you will look for everywhere to invest in it. So nobody invests in what you don't see value in. The next thing I want us to note down is that your relationship with God makes you very valuable. In fact, you are a high target material once you have a relationship with God. Your relationship with God makes you very valuable. You see, I'll use the government now to explain this now. The president is president there. Many people don't even know all his children, blah, 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 blah. But for the fact that they are related to the president, they are of high value. In fact, let me use this word that people can relate to very. They are of high kidnap value. Because people know if they can catch them, they have caught a heavy big fish. They are not catching the president, but at first you can catch somebody that is related to him. There's a relationship, there's some money must flow. That's how it is. So relationship with God makes you very valuable, and in the eyes of the devil, it makes you a high target object. The devil is attacking because he knows you have a very serious relationship with God. So he's attacking some other people that used to fornicate, steal, lie, kill. They'll be getting promoted. Say, oh God, these people are unrighteous. Why are they getting God? The devil is saying, devil cannot be fighting somebody in his kingdom. He's fighting because you're not in his kingdom. So he wants to reduce you to the same level. You shall not be reduced to nothing in the name of Jesus. So your relationship with God makes you very valuable. It makes you a high target person. It makes you very a threat to the enemy. So that's why the enemy comes at you with everything he got to come and fight you. Your relationship with God, very, very important. The next thing I want us to know them, because I'll be rounding up here, is this. God, and I think I'm going to stop here. Guard your relationship with God jealously. Guard your relationship with God jealously. Guard it very jealously. Guard your relationship with God jealously. Do not let anything separate you from God. Do not let anything cut your relationship with God. Guard it jealously, like your life depends on it. Because my brother and my sister, your life depends on it. Your life depends on it. Guard your relationship with God jealously, with all your heart, with all your soul. Guard your relationship with God jealously. Do not let the devil deceive you that, oh, this can listen. That's what he did to Eve. Oh no, if you eat the fruit, you will not die. It's a lie. Do not be deceived. Guard your relationship with God jealously, because the only reason why the devil is attacking you, the only reason why people are attacking you, why they are attacking you now, is because of that relationship. When that relationship is gone, they will leave you alone. So guard your relationship with God jealously. Do not let anything distract you from serving God, working for God. And I thank you for listening to this. I want to pray for us now. Anybody listening to this right now that has not accepted Jesus as their Lord and personal Savior, I want you to say this short prayer. Say, Lord Jesus, I come to you. Accept me. I know I have sinned. I know I have gone astray. Father, I come back to you. Father, be the Lord of my life. Be the God of my life. Take over my life. I come back to you. Accept me, Lord Jesus, for in Jesus' mighty name. I pray for everyone listening to this. Father, Lord, in this day, in this week, oh God, Father, Lord, miraculously surprise us. Father, Lord, in areas that we think it is impossible for a miracle to to appear. Father Lord, do the impossible, Lord God, and make the miracle appear in the name of Jesus. Father, every soul that needs a touch from you, Father, touch us in the name of Jesus. Father, every relationship with you that has been broken, Father, by your mercy, restore, restore. And Father Lord, remind us constantly how valuable we are to you, God. Father King of Glory, we thank you, God. And it shall be eternity at last with you, for in Jesus' most precious name. See, we meet again. Remember, it is loving God, touching life positively, serving God, connecting the world with his love and his presence. I am Fresh Fire. See you the next time we meet. God bless you. Amen. Thank you.